morning, Harvest. It's so good to be gathered together this morning. I want to say that, you know, all of us have walked in today with different trials and pain. But I want to assure us of this truth in Scripture this morning that's found in Romans chapter 8, that no matter the circumstance, we can be sure that God loves us. Romans 8 says this: "No, despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loved us. And I'm convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today or worries about tomorrow, not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. No power in the sky above or in the earth below. Indeed, nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord." So, church, this morning, can we celebrate that truth today? Let's lift our praise to the one who is worthy. That's right.
When all I see is the mountain, you see a mountain. And as I walk through the shadows, your love surrounds me. Oh, yes, it does. There's nothing to fear now, for I am.
When I fight,
so when I fight, now you got it.
sing this.
You gave your life for mine. Nailed to the cross, you crucified all my sin and shame. Was washed by your mercy.
You're the treasure.
You are the treasure I find. My reason for living, so let my life become an offering to the one who is worthy.
Come on, church, we sing all praise.
Yeah.
will sing the song of ages to thee.
To be here together this morning. My name is Dave. I'm one of the pastors, and I want to just take a couple of moments to connect on a few things. First of all, welcome. We're glad you're here. Great choice to start your week in worship. I want to welcome all of you, particularly though if you're kind of new today or new recently. We're so glad you're here. Today, there's something happening right after service. It's called Discover Harvest, and it's 30 minutes with some of our staff just to learn more about what's going on. So if you have 30 minutes, we'd love to have you. It's right across the hall right after church today. We'd love to see you there. For everybody, each time we encourage you to check in. So does anybody here have a mobile phone? Does anybody? Yeah, okay, well, of course we all do. So you can use the QR code on the chairs. You can use the app, which looks like the one on the right called Church Center. The app is actually really, really helpful to know what's going on in the church. You can check in for worship. You can let us know about prayer requests, and our staff prays through those every week. So please take advantage of that now. We are excited, guys. We've got something coming up called the Forged Men's Retreat. It's up at Camp Harvest. It's 3 weeks from this weekend. So we're going to show you a little bit about that. Let's watch this video.
But as for you, O man of God, pursue righteousness. Fight the good fight of the faith. On the Lord Jesus Christ. That's your story. We're in him by faith. And so all of these things are true about us. And therefore, because we're men of God, this is what we do.
All right. So guys, if you need a time away with the Lord, with some other men, you can get all the information at the website, harvestbible.org. It's 3 weeks from this weekend. Hey, one of the things we want to do is update you and then celebrate something that's been happening in the church. We've had an apprentice program. You might remember back in the fall, we said, hey, we'd love to have some young men, some young women lean into the church for about 9 months. They have been serving throughout the week in various ministries, worship ministry, student ministry, kids ministry, and others. And so on our campus, we've had Emmanuel. We've also had Jesse. Whoa. Love that. On all of our campuses, we also had Jesse and Sarah and Zuri, and they're just coming to the end of their apprenticeship now. So they've been doing this over the last 9 months. And I just got to tell you, it's been such a blessing to our church to have them lean in, and hopefully a blessing to you guys. It's awesome to see them grow in the Lord and in their ministry mindset and skills. And we want to take a moment to celebrate them, and but we also want to pray for them for what's next, all right? So let's all pray together. Lord, we just celebrate you, your creative work, how you knit us together in our mother's womb, how you save us, how you gift us for ministry, and how you use us. And Lord, for each of our apprentices, for Emmanuel and for each of the others, we've just watched you work in them and through them. And thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in them. We pray that in their next days and their next steps that you would just lead them to continue to honor you, to live for you, to serve you. And thank you, Lord, that you're building up your work in and through our church. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. Amen. Thanks, Emmanuel. Why don't we encourage him again? It's great. All right. We also are you probably know somebody who's graduating right about now. And so we want to just take a moment and congratulate and honor our graduates, particularly if you graduated from high school or college or post-college degree this season. Why don't you stand? And we want to encourage you and honor you. So I can't really see, but I'm going to, by faith, say that somebody's out there. Good, good. Excellent. Awesome. That's good. Why don't you remain? That's good. Way to go, guys. Why don't you remain standing for a moment? I know you love that part. And we just want to pray for you, all right? We're excited for you guys. Let's pray together. Lord, it's a lot of work to commit to a program, to see it through, to do all the things. You have been faithful, Lord, and we celebrate the hard work and the accomplishments here. But we also have a sense this is not primarily the end of something. It's primarily the beginning of a new thing. So would you, Lord, continue to draw each heart to you and grow them up in you and use them to be representatives of Jesus Christ wherever they go. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you that you will have been and you will be faithful. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Congrats, graduates. That's fantastic. Well, we're going to continue in worship now, and really worship it by its nature is offering something to the Lord. We offer our praises through singing. We offer our obedience and attention to his word. We offer service through our time and energy and gifts, and we offer worship through our giving. And so in this service, we're not going to pass anything up and down the rows, but it is important to pause and reflect and say, Lord, am I offering what I ought to be offering to you? And so Jesus said in Luke 12, for where your treasure is, there will be your heart also. And this is what happens. Our affections follow what we invest in. And so it's a time to pause, to consider, and to say, Lord, I love you. I want my heart to be yours. And part of that is us honoring him with what he's entrusted to us. So we're going to commit that now to the Lord. You can see the various ways to engage on the screen. But this is a heart matter. We want to commit it to the Lord and pray for the rest of our gathering today too. Let's pray. Lord, you are worthy. And there's nothing that would be better than for our heart to be yours, to be close to you. So Lord, as we sing, as we listen, as we serve, as we give, would you, Lord, be honored. And thank you for your faithfulness to us. And we just entrust this to you. Lord, in this service today, we ask that you would move in our hearts. We need to gather because we need to be reminded of who you are. We need to be instructed and encouraged and challenged. And Lord, have your way today, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Man, that was so peaceful to hear the birds chirping. I know it might have been hard for some of those who have only had a few hours of sleep last night to stay awake during that. It's almost like you're rocked to sleep. But I hope to keep you awake this morning. God's word should keep us awake, right? And so I'm excited to continue on in our series, Strangers in a Strange Land. So why don't you go ahead and grab your Bibles. Today we're going to be in 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. And last week, Pastor Jeff Bucknum took us through 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 12 through 25, which covered submission to government authorities and submission of slaves to their masters. And today in the text, we're going to see Peter tackle submission in marriage relationships. And so I want everyone to pay attention, all right? And what I mean by that is that some of you might be thinking, okay, they're talking about husband and wives this week, and I'm not a husband or a wife, but how many know that there's something in God's word for everyone? Every bit of God's word is profitable for our souls. And so if you're not married, but maybe considering getting married, you know, it's always good to be prepared for something before you get into it, right? Like, how awful would it be for you to board a flight and the pilot's like, hey, I've never flown before. Like, how would that go, right? Would you stay on that flight? I don't think so. But there's something in God's word for everyone. So if you are considering a marriage, there's something in the text here for you as well. But the title to today's message is Manner Matters. And Manner Matters is one of our staff values. And we believe that the manner in which we treat one another within God's community of the Christian faith, it matters. But it matters even much more so to those who are outside of the faith, right? Because as Christians, our actions speak louder than our words. And that's true, and it should be true, right? Like the moment that you tell someone that you're a Christian, or the moment that they find out that you're a Christian, it's like their antennas go up, right? They're watching you more intensively. They're watching our conduct and how we respond to the environments around us. 2 weeks ago, Jeff had, oh, it looks like the TV, okay. 2 weeks ago, Jeff took us through 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 11 and 12, which talks about this conduct. And this is what it says. It says, "Beloved, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh, which wage war against your soul." Verse 12 says, "Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they will see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation." And the Gentiles here, of course, we know are non-believers. And so Peter is saying, oh, well, he's encouraging us to watch our conduct, right? Because people are watching. And our conduct could maybe motivate someone to surrender their life to Christ. So Peter is covering these three major categories, okay? So we've already established last week, it was governments and slave versus the slave owner. But this week he's tackling marriages. But these were three big tension points for Christians. But as believers, our conduct should be the trailer to the movie of our life that's played out in front of others. So the truth of the matter is that the gospel is already offensive, right? So our conduct shouldn't make it even worse, okay? So the three points that I want to cover today are our conduct can win others to Christ, our conduct reveals our true adorning, and our conduct should be honoring. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity that we have to open up your word today. And I pray that the words that are on this page will penetrate our hearts. May we be changed from the inside out today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right, so our conduct can win others. And we see that in 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. It says, "Likewise, wives, be subject to your own husbands, so that even if some do not obey the word, they may be won without a word by the conduct of their wives. When they see your respectful and pure conduct." So Paul is saying likewise, right? But likewise to what? Let's go back a little bit here. Let's go to the text from last week. And the likewise is like this. It's in 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 21 through 23. And it says, "For this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you." So we have been called to suffer, it says. "Leaving you as an example so that you might follow in his steps. He committed no sin, neither was deceit found in his mouth. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly." And of course, he's talking that Jesus entrusted himself to God who judges justly. And so Peter is saying likewise, meaning in the same way. It means to an equal degree or similar to how Jesus Christ suffered for us, we sometimes have to suffer too for righteousness. But notice that Jesus was suffering because he submitted himself to the perfect will of God. And so I think right now it would be appropriate for me to take a pause for a moment and mention the fact that these verses in 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 1 through 7 are often misused, usually by men. And so we here at Harvest, we believe that no woman should remain in a relationship to where she is being abused, all right? And so if that is the case, we want to know about it, and we want to help you through that. So let a pastor know, or let your growth group leader know about that. Also, too, if you have suffered abuse in the past, just know that I am very sorry for that. And just know that there is help for you in that here at Harvest as well. But the point that Peter is trying to make here, he uses an example of an unequally yoked marriage. And an unevenly yoked marriage means that you have one spouse who's a follower of Christ and one who is not. And so if you look at the culture in which what was going on when Peter wrote this, I mean, it was really bad for women, okay? And we, of course, do not condone that behavior, but it was really, really bad. During that time, if a husband wanted to follow Jesus, it was okay, right? Because the wife would just naturally follow his lead on that. But if a wife during that time wanted to follow Christ, that was really tough. That was really hard. Because during those days, wives were considered property of men. So a husband could divorce his wife, or honestly, he could kill her. And that's unfortunate. But this example here gives a picture of a wife who is willing to lay down her life for what she believed, kind of like how Jesus did. So if a woman is professing faith in Christ during this time in this culture, it was a huge risk. But they were clearly suffering for righteousness' sake. If you look at the story of Joseph in the book of Genesis, he too suffered for righteousness' sake. Remember the story? His brother sold him into slavery, and he went silently, and he just remained faithful, and then the Lord exalted him and blessed him. This subject, too, is submission, but it's a voluntary submission based on the recognition of God's order. It is a submission that's based on a death of pride, and on the other hand, a desire to serve. Ideally, it is the submission not to fear, but of perfect love. There's nothing degrading about this submitting to authority and accepting God's ordained order. That alone ensures the proper functioning of the marriage bond between husband and wife. And so submission that Peter is referring to here means standing under authority. We need to recognize, first of all, that not only women should submit, but men should submit as well. Because men could trip through life totally unsubmissive to anyone and to do as they please. Peter underscored the fact that submission is demanded of all believers. And Paul echoes this as well in Ephesians chapter 5, verses 15 and 21. And this is what Paul says. Paul says, "Look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of time, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melodies to the Lord with your heart, giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of Jesus Christ, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. Submission is a good thing, and we do this to honor Christ. Peter says that the woman should submit to her own husband, meaning her husband, not like every man there is, except unless under the proper biblical standards of submission. There's a story about a husband who, his wife was a believer. She had been praying for him for many, many years. So one night he's out drinking with his buddies. And so he says, hey guys, you know, I bet you right now, you know, my wife is long gone, went to bed. I bet you if I brought you to my house right now, she'll wake up and prepare a meal for us. And the guys are like, cool, bet. We'll take that bet, right? So they go to the house. He wakes up the wife. The wife wakes up cheerfully saying, praise the Lord, I had two extra chickens. Great. So she starts preparing the meal and she's serving them cheerfully. And one of the guys says, madam, you're serving us knowing our current state, that we have been out drinking, but you are serving us cheerfully. Why are you doing this? And she says to him, I've been praying for my husband for years that he would surrender his life to Christ. And he hasn't so far. So I decided to serve him all of the days that he's here on earth, because when Jesus comes, it's not going to be so great for him. And the husband's like, what? Jesus? What? He's coming? And of course, that probably opened up a conversation about Jesus. Notice in the text, Peter says, one without a word. Charles Spurgeon, the great theologian, surmises that, or he gives this example of the culture at that time, in the fact that these women who were Christ followers, they would go to these secret meetings and they would hear a word from the Lord. Their unsaved husbands would not go, but these women would then come home cheerfully, with kindness and patience. And these men would look at the other women that were in the culture who didn't know the Lord and compare their wife to these women and say, wow, okay, I think I want a wife like that. What? Who is this Jesus? Jesus can do that in the heart of someone? I think I might be interested in something like that. Peter does not say that their wives after the Bible study should go home and say that there is no Jew or Greek. We are all equal in the sight of God, which is true. Colossians chapter 3 does say that. But no, Peter is encouraging them to use their actions. Peter wants the Christian women to win their husbands by a life of reverence and purity, expressed in a submissive attitude that honors the Lord and honors the husband as the head of the home. People who have never read their Bibles, Harvest, they're reading you. They're watching you every day. How we respond to the culture and how we respond to the political temperatures. Some Christians have become better politicians than Christ followers. And that's a problem in today's culture. There are ladies in this church who are in unevenly yoked relationships now as we speak. And I see how they are diligent and consistent in serving the Lord and in constantly inviting their husbands to church. And I get to see them once a year at Easter. But these are men who love their wives. They honor their wives. They just have not professed their faith in Jesus Christ yet. There's a situation that I'm very familiar with a wife here in our church who attended Harvest for many, many years and constantly living an honorable lifestyle in front of her husband. And their relationship had began to become abusive mentally. He began to mentally abuse her, and she wasn't having it. And she reached out to us, and it gave us an opportunity to intercede and call the husband in and sit down with him and open up God's word with him. And that husband surrendered his life to Christ at that moment. That husband is currently actively in biblical community, attending a small group each week, and he's growing in Christ. It is the character and conduct of a Christian that will win the loss. It's not arguments. It's not rebellious attitudes, but an attitude of submission, understanding, love, and kindness, and patience. And those qualities are not manufactured. Those qualities are fruits of the Spirit. So it's just that simple. Whether it is submitting to the government or submitting to an employer or in a marriage relationship, the role is the same. We submit as honoring to the Lord. God's ordained pattern for social relationships is to submit and to live out to the maximum to please the Lord. All right, point two. You guys trekking with me? All right, great. Point two, our conduct reveals our true adorning. And we see that in verses 3 and 4. It says, do not let your adorning be external, the braiding of hair and the putting on of gold jewelry or the clothing you wear. But let your adorning be the hidden person of the heart with the imperishable beauty of the gentle and quiet spirit, which is in God's sight, very precious. This word adorning means to decorate. So you would adorn a Christmas tree, or you might adorn your living room. Adorning means to make more beautiful or to make more attractive, to enhance something. The idea here is not putting a focus on the external, but more focused on the internal heart of what's on the inside. And depending on an outward adornment to win someone to the Lord, it could backfire on us. Because if we are focusing on using the outward appearance to draw someone into the Lord, it could speak to the lust of the eye. And the Lord would never use things of this world to draw someone to him. Gold jewelry will fade. But the hidden person of the heart, that being the Holy Spirit living on the inside of every believer, will never fade away. Peter is saying, enhance that. Enhance the inner person by spending time with the Lord in His Word, through prayer. Those things are imperishable. Peter is saying to enhance that, to make that more beautiful. The reason why outward adornments will especially not work in today's culture, because that is what we look for. Like, we see people on social media who are living their best life, putting everything on display. And I do mean everything on display, but not for a Christ follower. Our focus should be on the Spirit, building up the Spirit life, a life to where Jesus Christ reigns supreme. More of the Lord and less of the world. Our society idolizes beauty and entertainers. But beauty by God's standards is something that displays, or someone who displays integrity, if it reflects God's own righteousness. In other words, the beauty serves as an attraction to what God is and who God is. We are beautiful. The Holy Spirit is beautiful. And the Holy Spirit transforms lives. The beauty of holiness and character is a wonderful thing. It's a wonderful tool to draw people into a relationship with the Lord. Peter goes further in the description of someone who is adorning in their hearts in verse 5. Look at what he says. For this is how the holy women who hoped in God used to adorn themselves, by submitting to their own husbands. So this picture of someone whose heart is being adorned is someone who's spending a lot of time with the Lord. And so their hope is in the Lord. They're not focused on the daily woes of this world. They are focused on the future. They are focusing on the second coming of Jesus Christ. They are hoping on that. And in their hoping, their lifestyle is reflecting that. Looking to the hills in which comes their help coming from the Lord. No hope in the world, but hope in eternity. Peter brings in the example of Sarah in the text here too. And we see that in So he brings in an example of Sarah in verse 6. It says, follow along in your Bibles. We're on 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 6. It says, as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, you are her children if you do good and do not fear anything that's frightening. The interesting thing is Peter is using Sarah as an example here. And Sarah is a very popular person to the Jewish culture, right? Jewish culture has learned a lot about Sarah growing up and about Abraham as well. The major part of Israel's history was that they trusted in the Lord, for the Lord to lead them through a strange land into the new home, and to give Sarah and Abraham children. Those who were reading those stories are now reading this text. And also Sarah was known for her great beauty as well. So it speaks to the outward adornment that Peter was talking about here too. But although she was very beautiful, her inward adornment was so much more beautiful. But we know that Abraham was not exactly the best husband as well. I'm sure many of us are familiar with the story of him asking Sarah to not be his wife as they entered into the city. He said, hey, we're going to tell everyone that you're my sister, because he was afraid that they would kill him and take his wife because she was so beautiful. But even though he instructed her to do this, she submitted to that. And in that process, the Lord protected her. Now, I want to be clear on something here. Abraham and Sarah were doing the best that they could do at that time, right? But wives should never, ever follow a man that's leading her into sin intentionally, all right? That is a time where you stop, you draw the line, and you tell your husband, this is sinful, with the hopes that he will repent and you can move forward righteously. But in this case, they were doing what they knew to do. And in that, Sarah still honored Abraham, and God protected her. She continued to obey and called him Lord, because she put her trust in God, not in Abraham. It's a beautiful picture. This is an honorable picture. Abraham and Sarah were doing what they thought were right. But notice here, Peter did not highlight Abraham. Like, Abraham was, you know, he did a lot. You know, his father Abraham, who had many sons, we were descendants of Abraham. But he focuses in on the response of Sarah in this situation. The beautiful, beautiful response, and a great example for all of us. All right, we're trekking along. Now we're on point three. Our conduct should be adorning. No, our conduct should be honoring. And we see that in verse 7. It says, likewise, husbands, live with your wives in an understanding way, showing honor to the woman as the weaker vessel, since they are heirs with you of the grace of life, so that your prayers may not be hindered. That's scary. But first, let's unpack this. Okay, so likewise again. So I want to point out something here. So we spent a lot of time on wives submitting. There's a lot of verses there. And then I know some of you might be thinking, okay, there's only one verse for men. But notice the likewise, okay? So likewise meaning everything that I just said for men as well, okay? Honoring your wife, all right, in an understanding way. Honoring her as a weaker vessel, but doing it being filled with the Spirit. We treat our wives as precious gifts from God. We are to honor our wives. That should never be contested. Our wives are to be treasured, reassured, valued, protected, loved, and every tender provision made for them. These are what Christian husbands do. But also everything that we just covered as well, as I mentioned a few minutes ago, thus causing husbands to be Christ-like. We're called to love our wives as Christ loves the church. Whenever we're in a marriage counseling session and things are not going so great, First thing the husband goes to is, I'm loving her like Christ loves the church. She's just not submitting. Okay, well, great. Well, let's unpack that a little bit. What exactly does loving your wife like Christ loves the church mean? It just doesn't mean with words, right? It's with actions. Christ showed us that he loved us by example, by laying down his own life, by laying down his needs for us, by being patient, by sanctifying us. And this is not natural for us to do as men. That's why greater dependence on the Holy Spirit is so important. Remember Ephesians 18, we just shared it. Talks about not being filled with wine, but being filled with the Holy Spirit. And it's an ongoing process. It is the present tense. How are we doing with that? How is our prayer life, men? How is our time in the Word? Here the charge is to husbands to exercise our loving duty of being submissive to the needs of our wives, to their fears and to their feelings, to subordinate our needs to theirs. Whether she's a Christian or not, husbands are to show consideration and companionship. Again, husbands, not allowing abuse. The verse says that we are to live with our wives. That is a picture of dwelling together, being in unity together, cohabitating in the same bed. Whether your husband or your wife snores, that's not an excuse to go sleep in the other room. Take a trip to the doctor together and get that fixed, all right? Sleep apnea is not an excuse. Insomnia is not an excuse. A husband that's filled with the Spirit will fulfill his marital duties and love his wife. Tragically, one marriage survey says that the average married couple only communicates 37 minutes a week. 37 minutes a week. Not a day, but 37 minutes a week. No wonder why marriages fall apart when the kids go away to college. When a husband and wife become empty nesters, marriages tend to fall apart because they are strangers. They don't know one another. But the empty nester time should be the most fruitful time in your marriage relationship. You have more money, right? And you have more knowledge of each other. You know what each other's needs are, your wants, and what you like and what you don't like. That should be a fruitful time. I remember when my daughter was born, I thought ahead to what it would look like when she moved out. I mean, let's face it, our kids are only with us for a very small portion of our marriage relationships, maybe about a third. But what happens is when kids come in, the focus tends to turn on the kids, to where kids become idols, to soccer practices, to just praising our children for their achievements. And so then the regular needed maintenance in the marriage relationship is seldom done. Colossians chapter 3, verse 19 says, husbands, love your wife and do not be harsh with them. We honor our wives. Honoring. Peter also says, live in an understanding way. That means to continue to understand our wives. We continue to learn, continue to know, learn by experience, to take in knowledge of them, knowledge that goes beyond the merely functional, but speaks of a special relationship between a person who you know everything about. Someone asked Albert Einstein's wife if she knew the theory of relativity. And she says, I don't, but I do know Albert. Within a Christian marriage, both partners should know and continue to know all there is to know about each other. To say I never knew you felt that way is to say I never really knew you. And when either mate is afraid to be open and honest about a matter, it begins building walls instead of bridges. We should create a space to where each partner in the relationship feels open to communicate their feelings. And it's only through feeling that you're loved. Kind of like our relationship with the Lord, right? We tell him everything about ourselves, even though he already knows everything about ourselves, about us, right? The marriage relationship should be the same. Our spouse should feel comfortable in bringing everything to us, no matter what it is. It builds a closer bond and allows us to live together in an understanding way. Peter also says, giving honor to the weaker vessel. Weaker vessel does not mean that our wives are mentally weak or spiritually weak. It just means physically, right? There's a amazing, there's a great chance that I will beat Kathleen, my wife, in an arm wrestling competition, all right? Because I'm just stronger, and that's the way that God has made men. And so knowing that, we don't use that to lord over our wives. We don't use that to take advantage of them. We use that to nurture them. Peter also says she is a fellow heir. If we can see our wives as fellow heirs to the inheritance of a kingdom of heaven, if we can look at our wives as a sister in Christ, then maybe we can easily honor them on a regular basis. I always encourage our young adults who are dating, and young adults, remember, we only date to get married, okay? We date to get married. But during that period of time, I encourage them to look at this person that they're dating as a sister in Christ. And as you do that, it's easy to stay within the biblical guidelines that God gives us outside of a marriage relationship. But if we carry that into a marriage relationship, we can love our wives better. When we see her as a child of Christ and a co-heir to the kingdom of heaven, it will make us want to, yes, love them like Christ loves the church, but also sanctify them like we're called to do in our role as husbands. We treat our wives delicately in our reproach. And then the grand finale, so our prayers are not hindered. What a scary thought that is. Man, is that an attention getter or what? Like, if the mic is not on through this text, it should come on at that minute. That's a scary thought. Like, who would want their prayers to be hindered? We need the Lord, right? And we need him constantly. But this picture of prayers being hindered is more or less a separation between that husband and the Lord. Almost like the separation with Adam and Eve in the garden after they sinned. Remember? They sinned and then they went and hid. Someone who is caught in sin or is living a sinful life probably will not follow the instruction that 1 Peter is instructing here and is less likely to spend time with the Lord in prayer. The Greek word for hindered here is to cut off from. The Webster's definition says to make slow or difficult the process, causing harmful or annoying delays, interference with progress, failure to give honor due to our wise may result in cutting in on the efficiency of our prayer, probably both individually and together. And some of you might be like, what, I'm supposed to pray with my wife? Yeah, I think it's a good practice. But if you are at odds with your wife, you think you're going to pray together with her? Yeah, that will be hindered. Our fellowship with God could never be right if our fellowship with our fellow man is wrong. It is when you are not at one with each other that we are most apart from the Lord. When we are one with our wives, man, like we are one with the Lord as well. Look at what 1 John chapter 1, verse 19 through 21 says. It says, we love because He first loved us. If anyone says, I love God and hates his brother, he's a liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God who he has not seen. That's very convicting. Our brother here is our co-heir in Christ, our wives, our sisters in Christ. Our love, not only for other Christians, it's important, but our love for our wives is very important. No Christian husband should presume to think that any spiritual good will be accomplished in his life without an effective ministry of prayer. That's number one. And number two, no husband may expect an effective prayer life unless he lives with his wife in an understanding way, granting honor to her. So this is some tough stuff, guys. You know, there's a lot of the issues that we deal with here at Harvest as pastors have to do with marriage relationships. And it is, you know, one partner or another who has fell away from their relationship with the Lord, or there are things in this culture that have caused them to be lured away. Social media, video games, news networks, things that are taking the time that should be used for the Lord. It is my prayer that that's not the case here at our Rolling Meadows campus for our men, or even in our church, or even in the body of Christ. Man, on Friday night, we had our men's ministry night. And I don't wanna be that guy that tells someone that missed something that, man, you should have been there, that was amazing. But I'm gonna do it anyway because you should have been there and it was amazing. Anyone in this room who was there can attest to that. God moved in the hearts of the men here at our church. And I looked at these men who were there that night as the 300 who the Lord is gonna use to lead other men to the same level of repentance. Because there was some major repentance going on in Cornerstone on Friday night. It was amazing. I wept over the fact that other men were not there to experience what we experienced with the Lord on Friday night. And so guys, don't miss it. Like we're meeting monthly in the summertime. The next one is June 21st. Mark your calendar. Save the date. But even before that, we're going to Camp Harvest, all right? And that's a great time to get some things in order. When you are separated from the world that you know and are taken away to a quiet place where you can reconnect with the Lord, beautiful things happen under those circumstances. So I want to encourage you guys to take advantage of all of what the Lord has for us, because there's no manual on how to be a husband outside of God's word. Like when I got married, I wasn't handed a book other than the Bible, but it is useless if you don't open it, all right? So I know we get an opportunity to open up God's word every week, but let's open it up some other days of the week as well, and let's learn of what the Lord has for us as men. I'm focusing on the men now, because it is the men's duty to lead the household. As the man goes, as the household goes. And we like to say, as the man of harvest go, is how the man of harvest will go. I messed that up. I'm sorry. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your word and how it instructs us on not only how to be husbands and wives, but how to be Christians. And so, God, I just pray that today that the men and women in this room are encouraged in whatever category they're in. And I pray that it will ignite a fire in them to be better wives and better husbands or better followers of you. Lord, we thank you for everything that you're doing in the lives of your people. And Lord, we are thanking and praising you for things that you are still yet to do. Lord, you are working. We love you and we trust you in that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand and respond. God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do.
We worship and we serve a good God. He gives us clarity in his word of what he calls us to do, but it's not a trick. He's not like, good luck with that. He loves you. He gives you wisdom. He gives you strength. He gives you help. Where does our help come from? The Lord. And so if you're at a point where you're like, man, I would love to pray with somebody about that and how I can walk in that, we would love to do that. So come up front after service. We'd love to pray for you. We do have today Discover Harvest. I really want to encourage you to stop in. It's going to be about a half hour starting very soon right across the hallway. If you want to learn more, you want to meet a couple people, we'd absolutely love to have you there today. Hey, next week, do you know what time church is next Sunday? Nice job. I heard it from somebody. Next Sunday, and for the summer, we're going to have one Sunday morning service. So you are welcome to come at 9. You'll be early. It's at 10. Okay, 10 o'clock starting next Sunday. You come at 11, you're going to miss a lot. So 10 o'clock next Sunday through the summer. It's going to be sweet to be able to gather together in one service with our Sunday morning church family. So if we can be of help, please come and pray. We're going to go out now on mission for Jesus. As we do, know you are loved.